disregarding the scorn. And once it was broken and spilled out, the fragrance filled all the room. Like a prisoner released from his shackles, like a spirit set free from the tomb, broken and spilled out, just for love. Lavished on me, broken and spilled out, and poured at your feet in sweet abandon. Spilled out and used up for thee. Lord, you were God's precious treasure, his loved and his own perfect son. Sent here to show us the love of the Father, just for love it was done. And though you were blameless and holy, you gave up yourself willingly. You spared no expense for my pardon. You were broken and wasted for me, broken and spilled out, just for up for thee.
Susan, thank you very much. That's a great song for this week. It's Passion Week. Jesus Christ broken and spilled out for us. So, great, wonderful, thank you. At the end of World War II, Winston Churchill noted these words, really, at the beginning, I'm sorry, at the beginning of World War II, in the early years, he wrote these words for a speech. Defeat is bitter. There is no use in trying to explain defeat. People do not like defeat, and they do not like the explanations, however elaborate or plausible, which are given for it. For defeat, there is only one answer. The only answer to defeat is victory. This is the week of victory in the Christian church. Palm Sunday, Jesus comes into Jerusalem. Monday, he cleanses the temple. Tuesday, he debates with the scribes and the Pharisees in the temple courts. Wednesday, he reflects upon his mission in Bethany. Thursday, they celebrate the Lord's Supper. Friday, from 9 in the morning until 3 in the afternoon, Jesus hangs on the cross. Saturday, Jesus in the grave. Sunday, Jesus raised from the grave. Jesus resurrected. Easter Sunday. One third of the gospel story is given to the telling of this last week of Jesus' life. And in the Gospel of John, 50% of the Gospel of John is dedicated to the last week of Jesus' life. So this is the week of victory. Jesus Christ broken on the cross, his blood spilled out for us that we might have everlasting life. On Sunday mornings, we're talking about personalities from the Old Testament. And today we come to King Josiah. King Josiah, I invite you to open your Bible to 2 Kings, the book of 2 Kings, to chapters 22 and 23. 2 Kings, chapters 22 and 23. King Josiah. After Solomon died, the kingdom of God's people is divided into two parts, north and south. Israel to the north, Judah to the south. There are 39 kings in all, in both of these kingdoms. Very few of these kings are good. Josiah is the best of all the kings of Israel after Solomon's death. David was the best of all. Next to him is Josiah. Josiah was a young king. He died at the age of 39. He became king at the age of 8. And I want to look at three things from his life in 2 Kings chapter 22 and chapter 23. Three lessons I want you to consider. The first lesson is this. In the life of Josiah, I want you to remember, I want you to see again the tremendous value that the Bible holds for your life. The tremendous value the Bible holds for your life. That's one of the themes of the Bible. One of the lessons taught in the Bible is that the Bible itself has tremendous value for your life. And I want you to see it in this story as well. 2 Kings chapter 22, verse 1. Josiah is 8 years old when he becomes king. Verse 3, he's 26 years old. In the 18th year of his reign, 8 plus 18, 26. He's 26 years old when he sends one of his court attorneys to the priest to get some money to pay people to rebuild the temple. Shaphan goes to Hilkiah and pays him money for the workers who are rebuilding the temple. Hilkiah tells Shaphan something. Hey, guess what I found? What did you find? I found the Bible. It's been lost. Now, you might think that's rather unusual. I think it is. That the people of God would have lost the Bible. But they lost it. It's been lost for a long time. It's been lost for so long that some people don't even remember that there was a Bible. The Bible as it existed in that day had been lost. Hilkiah finds it. Hilkiah gives it to this administrator for Josiah, and he takes it to King Josiah, and you can see in verse 10 that he reads it to King Josiah. Shaphan read the Bible in the presence of the king. Now, if you look at the next verse, you find the response, verse 11. 2 Kings 22, verse 11. The king heard the words of the Bible, and he tore his robes. He was convicted. He becomes aware, acutely aware, of the fact that he's sinful. He doesn't measure up. He thought he was doing better than he was. He thought he was better than he was. But when the Bible is read, the Holy Spirit convicted him of his sin, and he became so aware of it, his sin, and the sins of the people of his kingdom, that he tore his robes as a symbol of the inner turmoil that he felt due to the weight of his sin upon his heart. He was convicted. The Bible has tremendous value for you. Tremendous value. Because it shows you the truth about your life. You're a lot worse than you think you are. And I say that with all kindness. I am too. I'm worse than I think I am. Because I rationalize my behavior. I compare myself to inadequate standards. But the Bible tells me the truth about who I am. The Holy Spirit uses the Bible to make me aware of the fact that I'm far, far short of what I ought to be. The Bible is the tool God uses to make me aware of my shortcoming, as it were. When I was in the fifth grade, I lived in a little town in central Texas for just a few years by the name of Winters. It's south of Abilene, north of Ballinger. My dad was transferred there for 2 years. From Monahans to there, we came back to Monahans. But for 2 years, I was in Winters. Fourth grade, fifth grade, first part of the sixth grade, I spent there. When I was in the fifth grade, I was running around with a bicycle gang of boys, and we terrorized the east side of Winters. And this new boy moved into town. He was a little overweight, wasn't particularly athletic, was a little shy. And so the gang that I was part of, we picked on him and bullied him a little bit. And one day after school, he was riding on his bike home, and we chased him down, pushed him, shoved him, tore his shirt. Nothing terribly violent, but it was very bad what we did. And so I went home, didn't think much about it. Didn't really give it any thought. I did not tell my mom, as you can well imagine. Didn't tell my father, of course. Went to school the next day just like everything is cool and good and dandy. And about 2 or 3 hours into school, there was a knock on my classroom door, and I was invited to come to a meeting. And I started sensing on the way to that meeting that things were not going to go well in this meeting. The principal was in there. My dad was in there. My mom was in there. When I walked in the door, I thought, uh-oh, this is not good. That boy was in there. His mom was in there. His dad was in there. And the principal confronted me. He said, "This is what I understand that you did. You chased him down on your bike yesterday, pushed him around, tore his shirt, knocked his glasses off. Did you do that?" I plead the fifth. No, I said, yes, I did that. I did that. Confronted. I didn't feel that bad about what I had done, really, all, honestly, until I was confronted. When I was confronted, I all of a sudden started to feel really badly about what I had done. There was the evidence. There were the guilty, there was the guilty party. There were parents, my parents, the principal. Everyone was there. I was confronted, and I had to own up to what I had done. I probably would never have owned up to it, may not even have considered it very important had I not been confronted about it. But when confronted, I had to face the reality of what I'd done. Maybe you've done some things like that. The value of the Bible is, and I want you to hear this, the Bible confronts you. It's confrontational. It doesn't let you off the hook. The Lord God knows who you are. He knows what you're like. He knows your inner sins, your inner thoughts. He knows you inside and out. God does. God knows you. And the Lord wants you to become aware of who you are so that you will see the need to come to Jesus as Savior. So He confronts you. And the means by which God confronts you is through the Bible. So in a sense, the Bible is like the principal in the school. The one who confronts people when they do the wrong thing and holds them accountable for what they've done. That's what the Bible does. If you did not have the Bible, you would rationalize your behavior. Justify your behavior. Compare yourself with someone that you're better than and think, well, I'm okay. After all, I'm better than he is. That's what we do. But the Bible doesn't let us off with that. It confronts us. King Josiah was confronted when he heard the Bible. And that's what happens to us. You need to come to church every Sunday. You need to read the Bible. You need to hear it preached. You need to hear it sung. Because the Holy Spirit takes the Bible and He shows you who you are. And when you know who you are, you realize that you need Jesus and you turn to Him in faith, you see. It's a wonderful thing to have the gift of the Bible. That's the first thing I see in this text about King Josiah, the value of the Bible. The second thing I see is in chapter 23, where Josiah repents. And I want you to see that in his repentance, verse 4 of chapter 23, he removes all the foreign gods from the temple. That's a good thing. In verse 10 of chapter 23, he desecrates or destroys Topheth, which is in the valley of Ben-Hinnom. Topheth was a place down south of Jerusalem where people sacrificed their own children. They would heat up Topheth and take their child. Topheth has these arms of metal, and you would heat him in the cavity of the idol. These arms would become scalding white hot with their outstretched hands like this. And the people were so wicked that they would take their babies so that the crops would grow, or for this reason or another, and put them on those scalding hands of Topheth. How terrible that is. How terrible that was. Josiah did away with it. Josiah destroyed Topheth. He abolished Topheth. No more Topheth down in the valley of Ben-Hinnom. Josiah said, no more of that. We'll have that no longer. He repented and destroyed it. The killing of innocents. I wanted to see this week, so I looked again about what we do in the United States of America with the killing of innocents. Roe versus Wade, 1973. Since Roe versus Wade in the United States of America, since 1973, we have aborted 44,012,775 babies legally. 44 million. 44 million babies. In 2016, that's the latest year for which we have data, 77,983 legal abortions. This is according to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC. The population of Texas is 28,450,000. Now, I want you just to imagine, best you can, all the people in Texas. Think about Houston, the teeming thousands of people in Houston, and Dallas, and Fort Worth, and San Antonio, and Austin. And it seems like 500,000 live in Odessa and Midland, don't you think? There are so many people out there. 28 million people in Texas. Since 1973, in this country, we have aborted 44 million babies. Josiah stopped the killing of babies down in the valley of Ben Hinnom by destroying that idol that was there. They are better than we are. We read the text and we say, look how evil they were. They're better than we are. What they did is not as bad as what we're doing. 44 million. Can you imagine that? That's since 1973. What does true repentance look like? False gods are removed, and the value of human life is proclaimed and upheld. That's what repentance looks like. We are a wicked, wicked country. And we have around us great wickedness. Great wickedness. The very fact that we're here alive today and able to worship, drive our car to church is due to the mercy of God. We don't deserve it. We say the Nazis were evil. They were evil. They killed 10 million Jews. We have aborted 44 million babies, little babies. Wow. Wow. In the Bible, the people repented over such evil. One final thought I draw your attention to from this text. Josiah was the best king in Israel. He was the best leader, the most righteous man, the best king other than David that the people of God ever had. Yet Josiah suffered and died at an early age. In fact, I want to put on the screen one verse that summarizes his life and then a verse that talks about his death. Here's a summary of Josiah's life. Neither before nor after Josiah was there a king like him who turned to the Lord as he did. Josiah turned to the Lord with all his heart, with all his soul, and with all his strength, in accordance with all that the Bible of his day had to say. He loved God. He worshiped God with his heart, with his soul, and with his strength. But look about the end of Josiah's life. How does he die? He dies in battle at an early age. While Josiah was king, Pharaoh Necho of Egypt went up to the Euphrates River to help the king of Assyria. King Josiah marched out to meet Pharaoh Necho in battle. But Necho faced him and killed him at Megiddo. He's the best king Israel ever had. He's just getting started. He's 39 years old. He's good. He rediscovered the Bible. He destroyed child sacrifice. He turned people back to God. His grandfather was Manasseh, the worst king Israel ever had. And Manasseh lived 55 years and did evil beyond description. 55 years he rules. Here comes one who starts at age 8, but only rules 31 years and dies at age 39. You might think, wow, why would God do that? Why would God allow Manasseh to live and rule for 55 years and Josiah to live and to rule for only 31 years? And he started at age 8. I don't know. We don't understand everything that God does. But I'll say this. You can suffer. It's altogether possible that you can suffer as a Christian in ways maybe that are harder to take even than people who are not Christians suffer. It's possible to suffer. It's possible to suffer physically or financially or maritally or vocationally or relationally or in your family setting. Maybe you'll be persecuted for your faith. It's possible to suffer. Christians really do suffer. That's part of the Easter story. The Easter story is not this story. The Easter story does not say that God is going to bless you in every single way and make you perfectly happy and give you everything you ever wanted in this life. That's not the Easter story. The Easter story says you may suffer in this life. You may feel pain in this life. You may suffer many different kinds of ways in this life, but your hope is in the next life. Christianity is not secularism. Secularism says this world is all we have. Christianity says the best we have is not this world, it's the world yet to come. So if we suffer, we suffer. If we die, we die. Thank God there is a heaven in which there is no pain, there is no crying, there is no loss. And there is no death there. So let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the opportunity this morning to read the Bible. Three great lessons here. We see the value of the Bible. It confronts us, Lord, with regard to our sin. We see, Father, that true repentance involves a respect for life. And Father, we realize how far we are from that, even in our own country. And Father, we are reminded of the fact that you don't promise us a bed of roses in this life. But Father, you do promise us that in Jesus, we will be with you forever. in heaven, a place of perfect bliss with no pain, no suffering, no evil, no sin, no death. So I pray, Lord, for every person who's gathered this morning. I pray that we would look to Jesus. I pray, Father, that we would confess our sins. I pray, Father, that we would fall down and worship Jesus in our hearts and in our minds. And Father, I pray that you would prepare us through this week for the great Sunday on the Christian calendar, Easter Sunday, this coming Sunday, when we celebrate Jesus' victory over death. We pray, Father, that you will bless our steps this week in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand together and sing. If you have a commitment to make for Jesus, make it even now.